بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Allah tells us in Surah Sad, in Surah 38, that the Quran was sent down, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. Allah mentions that this book, this Quran, was sent down, this blessed book was sent down in order that you reflect deeply over its verses. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. And it's a reminder for people of intellect, for people who reflect, for people of intelligence. So that has to do with the Quran in its totality. That we're not just supposed to go through the Quran cover to cover, reading, listening, and we go through it once, twice, thrice, and nothing changes. Rather, we're supposed to pause and reflect at different points in the Quran, different points that seem to jump out of the page at us, that seem to jump out of, you know, the speaker at us if we're listening to Quran, perhaps as opposed to reading for that period of time. Sometimes there are some ayat, some verses that they jump out at you, and it really feels like this story or this verse or this chapter, it feels as if it was revealed specifically for my particular situation, right? And these are the same ayat that were revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam several centuries ago, over 1,000 years ago, to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Yet we still find this fresh fruit coming from this amazing Quranic tree, so to speak. I want to highlight in particular two instances that we find in the Quran. And again, if we're supposed to reflect over the Quran, then that definitely includes the stories contained within the Quran. So we don't just want to learn about, to read about, to listen about Moses and Pharaoh, about Prophet Musa alayhi salam and Fir'aun. We don't just want to read it and then that's about it, as well as other stories contained within the Quran. We want to reflect over them. I'll give you two quick examples, and that'll be inshallah. One, if you look at the story of Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, if you look at Surah Yusuf, and you look at how from the beginning of the story, he mentions this dream that he had to his father, Prophet Yaqub alayhi salam, and his father tells him, don't go and tell your brothers because shaitan is going to cause problems between you guys. One thing leads to another, and things basically get worse and worse after that point. Prophet Yusuf alayhi salam, his own brothers, they throw him into a well. And then he ends up as a child slave in a foreign country. And then he at least ends up in the house of Al-Aziz, the second in command for Egypt. At least he ends up in those circumstances, but then what happens within those circumstances? The wife of Al-Aziz tries to seduce him, and he passes that test. But then what happens? He ends up in jail as a result of maintaining his innocence and his purity. So actually, because of his purity, he ends up in prison. He ends up in jail. So up until that point, things, they got worse and worse. He ends up in the well, and then he ends up, you know, picked up by this caravan, and then he's sold to this family, and then, you know, the wife of Al-Aziz tries to seduce him. He maintains his purity and innocence. And as a result of that, you know, she threatens him with jail. And his preference was between the two. Okay, I'd rather, and he makes dua, ya Allah, I'd rather prefer this one. So he ends up in jail. So you find one challenge after another. What I want to highlight here is specifically when he's in this time, you could say, of isolation, when he's isolated from general society. Right, he's stuck in those circumstances, and obviously that's 1,000 times worse than quarantine. But the dotted line that I want to connect between our circumstances, generally speaking, in quarantine, to his time in prison, in jail, in isolation, you could say, separated from society, cut off from essentially everyone else, for the most part, except for some people. What's the line that I want to draw here, this dotted line, just because obviously they're very different, but work with me on this one. Quarantine you know, these days in our situation, and then his situation being in jail, in prison, isolated, right? Struggling with that. What happens right after that, though? And again, this is, you know, we're supposed to reflect when it comes to Quran. We don't just want to read it cover to cover with no reflection. That what does that really do? The true barakah is contained within the meaning of the Quran and the practice of the Quran as best we can. What happened? What was the next phase right after his phase of isolation? After his isolation, the greatest doors of his life opened immediately after that. He's in prison, and then the Malik, the king, has a dream. And because of that dream and his interpretation, he basically not only gets out of jail, he not only gets out, his innocence is also established, his record is cleared, and it's proven that he never did anything wrong in the first place. And he ends up in the position himself as Al-Aziz at that time. SubhanAllah, so he went from this really difficult period of isolation, and the next phase, things went from here, way up here, from rags to riches overnight, essentially. And what facilitated that? This one person, the king, had this one dream, no one else could interpret it, and then one thing led to another. My point is, right after this really difficult period of isolation, the greatest doors of his life opened. Compare that to our situation now in quarantine. There are many struggles that many people are dealing with as it relates to quarantine and this whole COVID scenario. Allah knows, but maybe your greatest doors, maybe our greatest doors, maybe that's the next phase right after this, bi-idhnillah. Right? So that's what we hope for, and that's what we pray for. That's example number one. Example number two, you find Prophet Sulayman alayhi salam asking Allah for forgiveness and then asking Allah for kingdom. A kingdom such that is so awesome that not a single person will ever have anything like it after him. رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي وَهَبْ لِي مُلْكٍ لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِّن بَعْدِ إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَّابِ. And notice how he connects one of Allah's names with it. He asks Allah for forgiveness. And then he asks Allah for this amazing historic kingdom and power. And he connects Allah's name, Al-Wahhab, with Innaka Anta Al-Wahhab. Indeed, you are the most generous, not just in general, but extremely generous, especially with like sizable gifts. And Allah gives and gives and gives. And it, you know, Allah doesn't lose anything from giving anything. Right? Allah is most generous. So he asks Allah for forgiveness, then he asks Allah for something amazing. Something awesome. And he connects a relevant name of Allah with that dua. And look at Allah's response. Allah's response, Allah's response. Allah gave him that and more, you could say. And on top of that, what does Allah say? فَمْنُنْ أَوْ أَمْسِكْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. SubhanAllah, Allah didn't just give him this amazing, awesome, you know, super unique kingdom, which, by the way, the reason why he wanted it was for Allah. He wanted power for Allah. He wanted kingdom for Allah. This was his niyyah. Allah gave it to him. Right? What do you find at the end of that? Allah tells him. What does Allah say? فَمْنُنْ أَوْ أَمْسِكْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. So Allah tells Prophet Sulaiman alayhi salam, so give or withhold whatever you decide, بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Like, you're not going to be held accountable either way. Try your best, and I know you're going to try your best. That's your track record. That's what you're going to continue to do. Why does Allah say this? To relieve pressure. To relieve pressure. I trust you. Try your best. You're going to do just fine. And it's up to you. What you give, what you withhold, the pressure is off. It's up to you. And that actually helps to facilitate progress and growth when that pressure is removed. The last thing I'll mention, tomorrow is the day of Arafah. The Prophet taught us, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that whoever fasts the day of Arafah, then his anticipation, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, was that their sins from the previous year are forgiven, and their sins from the coming year are forgiven as well. Of course, this is referring to minor sins, to little things that are overlooked, and you know, mistakes, little mistakes that happen here and there. This basically this polishes the car in regards to both years, the last year and then also the coming year. So imagine there's this amazing car polish that if you polish your car tomorrow, metaphorically speaking, any scratches that happened over the last year, though, they're going to be gone. Your car's going to shine. And this polish is so awesome. It's going to continue to shine, right? For the next year as well. Subhanallah. We ask Allah for polished hearts. We ask Allah to guide us and forgive us. We ask Allah for forgiveness. We ask Allah for tawfiq. We ask Allah for consistency. We ask Allah for istiqamah. We ask Allah for steadfastness. Amin Rabbil Alameen. So again, to quickly recap, Prophet Yusuf, maybe right after this quarantine, the greatest doors of your life will open. And we ask Allah for that for you. The second point, look at the formula of Prophet Sulayman. Ask Allah for forgiveness, then ask Allah for something that you may think is huge and seemingly impossible, but for Allah, that's easy. وَمَا ذَلِكَ عَلَى اللَّهِ بِعَزِيزٍ. And then number three, tomorrow is Arafah. We ask Allah to guide us and forgive us. أَمْنِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ سُبْحَانَ رَبِّكَ رَبِّ الْعَزَّةِ عَمَّا يَصِفُونَ وَسَلَامٌ عَلَى الْمُرْسَلِينَ وَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.